Hello.
Welcome everybody. I don't know if the last everybody been introduced, but I haven't actually met myself, so I'm going to introduce myself. Hi, I'm David, nice to meet you. Okay, so I'm David Fraser from St. James Software, and I'm talking about SQL Alchemy, and I presume that some of you have some idea what SQL Alchemy is, so that's why you came here. But basically what I'm going to do is actually run through the SQL Alchemy RRM tutorial. So this will be a very hands-on session. I know just many of you don't have laptops, so you should write down the code that you would have written on your laptop and try it out. But I'm actually going to be stepping through that. So I'm not going to leave that now that we have the slides. The tutorial thing is actually, I put a GitHub site there, which you can check out, anybody who's wanting to follow along. But basically, you're going to follow how to use SQL Alchemy primarily in the RM layer. So what SQL Alchemy is for use in relational databases. Does anyone here not know what a relational database is and not familiar with the concept? Yay. Okay. Either you're too scared to admit it, or I'll assume that you can. So it does a whole lot of things at different layers, and the RM layer is the kind of top layer of that. So there's all kinds of concepts of SQL Alchemy maps, which you can go and do lots of useful things with. But to get going with it, this is the easiest thing to use, but there's plenty of other stuff that you can explore. So in Python, we have this thing called the DB API, which is like the standard way of interacting with a relational database. And so SQL Alchemy will use just about any DB API provider. So whether you're talking to Oracle, or SQL Server, or Postgres, or MySQL, or SQLite, there are providers for all these things, and they work pretty well. And it does a good job of abstracting the database independence away from you. Okay, so the philosophy behind SQL Alchemy. So there's a statement that all abstractions are leaky. You cannot pretend with your nice encapsulated code that there isn't something else that is talking to underneath, if there is. Like, at some point, it will escape and you'll have to go and dig down into it. So SQL Alchemy is built with that in mind. The whole philosophy is that you're meant to understand what the database is doing, but you're not meant to have to perform acrobatics and do nasty things in order to interact with it. So it's trying to wrap the actual concepts the database is presenting to you in a iconic way that makes sense and is usable, but it's not designed for you to just say, well, I won't think about my objects. They'll live in the database somewhere, and I'll just assume that the library's taken care of them. It is designed for you to hand code stuff that you know what's happening with them, but you don't have to worry about some of the things that are very unpleasant. Okay, so it does a nice job, as I said, with database independence. So if anybody's worked on lots of different databases, you can have lots of headaches. It's quite fun. So different relational database vendors are not in the game of saying, we want everybody to be able to use our database, we'll make it the same as all the others. They want to say, we want everybody to only use our database, so we shall make it different, and then it will never be able to migrate their application off it. So there are these SQL standards, they're great. And then there's what the databases actually do, which mostly follows the SQL standards, but there are all kinds of things that aren't covered by the SQL standards. And so when you get into slightly more complex SQL, you often have to emit slightly different SQL for different databases. And so there's a whole set of classes in SQL, inside SQL Alchemy that will represent the intention of your SQL statement and then express it in a way appropriate to whatever database you're using. And the other interesting thing with databases often the data types. This thing is causing noise. The types And then there are classes for the actual schema items. So there's classes for tables, columns, indexes, all those kind of things, and there's classes that are written in SQL sets. But we don't care about any of those for now because we want to do ORM. So what we're going to do is we're going to work through the standard ORM tutorial, and I'm going to show you how you use SQL Alchemy. So I'm actually going to pretend to type out the tutorial in an interpreter prompt, because that's fine. So I can type very fast. Okay, so this, what we want to do is import SQL Alchemy. This is running the latest stable version, but all the 0.7 versions are pretty similar. There were a few changes, which somebody was talking about earlier. And we want to make a new engine. So this example is all done with in-memory SQLite database, because then we have to wrap around with connections and servers being up and so on. But most of the stuff will just run fine on a different thing. So as you can see there, there's a what's called a URI for the database. So it's saying this is this kind of thing, and if you were connecting to like a Postgres server or MySQL server, you would have a host name or server name and port and things like that in there. But this one is just connecting to SQLite. And it's got this nice parameter echo equals true. Now that says when you execute SQL statements, print them out so we can see what's going on. So that's going to be useful for us because we're going to see what's happening. Okay, so let's try and run some SQL. So we're going to actually just write some manual SQL here. And so because we've got the database, we can just execute the command against it without having to worry about setting up connections for now. And we wanted to return the result. Sorry, is this not big enough? Let's make this bigger. How did the point anybody sees actual characters? You read that? Okay. Okay, so there we see the SQL login coming out, and so it's running select one, because that's what we told it to, and it's not passing any parameters, and it's giving us a result of one, which is exactly what we wanted. Okay, that's boring, let's do something more interesting. Okay, so there's a layer in SQL Alchemy called declarative, which is originally when they built the ORM, you have to do all this kind of manual work of mapping your object class to the table. Now, nobody actually wanted to do that unless you were doing something unusual. So declarative basically lets you do something sensible. And what it has is got this meta class called declarative base. And basically you set up your own class, which is the root of all your classes. And if you want to customize the way that thing works, that's why they've got it. You can do all kinds of things like make it set up automatic column naming conventions and stuff. But by default, you can just use it out of the box. So we've got a base class, and we are going to now construct our first ORM record class. Okay, so we need some data types, we need columns, and here's our class coming. Okay, so I don't know how visible the bottom of the screen is going to be, which is a shame. So we're constructing a class, and we're going to tell it explicitly what table it's going to use. So you say this class is going to correspond to this table. So hold on, how many people know what an ORM is? Okay, most people. So the basic concept is, we have got a database with tables in it, and we've got objects living in our system. What we want is for each record in the tables to correspond to an object in our system when it's loading, when you're interacting with it. So what we do is we create a class for every table, and that class will contain a field for every column, and when I'm interacting with a record, I'll have an object that represents that record. I can make changes, then the master database, add new records, and so on. So that's what this user class is going to be. So what we're actually doing is building a blogging application, but we're not going to get very far with it because we don't have enough time. So we're just going to construct the tables. Okay. So I want some columns on it. So I'm going to set up an ID column, and I'm going to tell it this is an integer column, and it's the primary key. So for integer primary key columns, automatically it's going to set them up as an already implementing sequence, which is quite fun. And I need a name for the user, and I want to know what the user's full name is. I need to recommend them Jonathan Henry Spencer. Why did we do that? And then I need a password, and I'm going to have a constructor. Now, if you don't want to build a constructor, there's a default one built in, but that's just letting you pass in the parameters. And I want to know what it is when I push that. Okay, so we have our user class. Okay, so there it is. And amongst other interesting things, it's got underscore underscore table thing. So when I constructed this class, the meta class automatically went and constructed the SQL Alchemy table object that knows about all the columns that that class is going to require. Okay, so let's look at it. There we go, it's a table, it's called users, it's got metadata, it doesn't know what database it connects to, but it's got lots of columns. Okay, so that's nice. And then the other thing that we have is we've got a mapper object, which is the thing I was telling you about, which nobody wanted to actually build themselves. This is a special thing that helps to glue between the table and the user. You don't really need to worry about that unless you're doing arcane stuff. Okay. that table doesn't yet exist in the database, so we're going to tell our base object, it's got a metadata thing on it, which corresponds to all the metadata data in the database, and we're going to tell it, create all the tables that I've declared so far, of which there's one. So when we do this, we should see some nice SQL happening. Whee! Okay, so it's gone and created a table with all the columns that we wanted, and with the appropriate primary key. So, okay, so that set up the table. Any questions? Yeah. Now that I look at it, I'm not sure how it sets up the sequence. It's got this auto increment function. I think SQL can manage that itself. You can probably plug it at some point. That was a terrible answer. I won't ask any more questions. Okay. Let's do something simple. Let's go ahead, Edward. Oh, hold on, David.
Was not a correct way to go about it.
Yeah.
In situations like that, if all else fails, you can always insert one record in where you specify an ID.
Yeah.
It will then, the incrementer should catch up. You delete that record, it will have a persistent record for this incrementer to set the table, and it should run from there. It's a messy solution, but you can hack the system that way.
Yeah. Okay. So we have good old Ed Jones, and he selected a very secure password for himself, Ed's password. Can I rearrange the screen so that people can actually see it? Is that better if it's higher up? Okay, otherwise we're going to have netpack at the end of the screen. Okay, so I've constructed him, and now he's got a name, and he's got a password, and so I can, this object has obviously got those attributes on it, so I can try and compete on it, and I can say, oh, what's his ID? Oh, dear. Poor old Ed has no identity whatsoever. He's lost in the mixer world of postmodernism. So, Ed doesn't know who he is yet, because he doesn't actually exist in the database yet. All I've done is construct him as an object, and I haven't attached him to a connection and sent him through to the database yet. So that's a real shame for him. If we don't actually do something with him, he'll disappear into the virtual world. So, he's none. Okay, so what do we need? We now need to know how to talk to the database with sessions. So I'm going to construct a session. Now, the way you do this in SQL for me is you create your own little session class, and that automatically knows which database engine you're talking to. So when I've got the session maker thing here, when I give it a bind parameter, it's going to say every session that I create of that class is going to know that it's talking to that database. You can configure it later if you want to, but it's helpful to not be doing that all over the place. So let's make a new session, and I want to put it into my session. So the session object contains a set of objects, or a set of records that correspond to the database. So they can be in various states, which we're going to investigate now, but we're going to add Ed as a new user to this thing. He doesn't yet exist in the database, but at least the session object knows now when it's finished, it wants Ed to actually be ready in the database. Okay? So there he is. We've added him. So shall we try and see if we can find him in the database? Now, at this point, you'll notice there's been no SQL run so far. So that means the database doesn't yet actually know about him, but we're going to try and query for him in any case. So this is now getting into some real SQL for me writing. So we're going to create a query object on the user class, and we're going to say, I want to look for somebody whose name is Ed. We'll explain the filters a little bit more just now. And I want to get the first record that comes out. So this is a cunningly constructed tutorial because it looks like the first simple example of running a SQL statement. What it actually is going to do is a whole lot of strange things. Okay, so the session object actually, when it gets this request, it goes, they're trying to query the database, but I have something that the database doesn't know about yet. He's called Ed, and I would like to tell the database about him, because if we're querying for him, we should make sure he's there first. So there's a concept called a flush in SQL Alchemy, where a session will flush all of its change state into the database so that any operations that are taking place will actually operate on that change state. So when you do a query, if there's anything that's marked as dirty in the thing or is new, then it will actually send it off to the database and then run your query. Okay? Does that make sense? So it's starting a new transaction and it's running out insert. So it's constructed my SQL query to insert the appropriate values into the database, and it's sending them as parameters, which is good because you don't have SQL injection problems where you can, the SKCD comment with the guy whose name was something semicolon altered password. So this can't do that unless you trick it in an extra special way. So it's putting in and then it's running a query to select all the columns out. And there we are. It should have returned us somebody called our user. So let's look at our user. Woo, he's Ed. So but now the interesting question is, do we now have another object? We created him in the first place, has it given us back a different Ed? In which case he's got a split identity. And the answer is no, it's actually returned the same object. So it will try and match when it returns a new object and say, oh, this is actually the same thing. So if we change something on Ed user or our user, they're actually the same Python object, it'll be okay. Right, questions? Yes, excellent question. So beforehand, when I tried to look at Ed user or ID, he wasn't there. But now he's got one. He's number one. Everybody else is number two all over. Okay. So it's only boring only having one user, so let's put some more in. So we want Wendy, Mary, and Fred. Even the Flintstone is misspelled, which is terribly sad. It was part of the Flintstone clan that kind of didn't like the first T. So we're going to add a bunch of new users. Now, can anyone tell me, do these exist in the database yet? No, because we haven't got a flash yet. They are just objects living in memory at the moment that are waiting to go in. But the session knows about them. We want to change his password so we can set an attribute on him. Okay, now we're going to look and see what's actually happening inside the session. So the session keeps track of the different objects that it's got in different ways. And it can tell you which things have been modified. That's called dirty. It doesn't mean that Ed's a dirty person. It means that he's got an attribute that's changed because he decided his password wasn't so secure. So, and then it's got new users, and it's going to commit. But I don't actually commit now, let's just look at this a bit more. There's also deleted users, and they are seeing deleted users. And you can actually, if you just iterate over the section, it will iterate over all the objects that are in it. So I can see all the users that belongs, user records that belongs to the session. Okay. Now, if we do a commit, the commit actually triggers a flash first and then commits on the database. So at that point, this is going to become rail. So at the moment, actually, we didn't commit Ed, so he lives in this current database transaction, but if another transaction was to start, they wouldn't necessarily see him. At this point, when we commit, all of these changes are going to be actually made permanent in the database. So you do have to be aware of underlying semantics of the database to do this sort of thing. Okay, let's commit them. Whee! Lots of SQL. So decided to update Ed first and then insert all the other guys. Okay. So any questions so far? Yes. Yes. You're asking what it is. I can tell. I thought I'd given a perfectly satisfactory answer. So SQL Alchemy has a concept called a unit of work, which it bundles things together and it orders them depending on what relationships exist between things, which I'm going to get into later. So sometimes there'll be database constraints that require certain operations to be done first, and we'll do them in that order. It's not necessarily going to happen in the order that you ran the like attribute alteration things. And sometimes, if you've got side effects, doing some things in the database will trigger other things, which will then trigger another flash with multiple rounds of these things to pick up. Okay. Do you have another question? Okay. So, and that's what we were saying earlier. What? I just asked Ed for his ID. And it did a query. That's fine. Why did it do that? Okay, the reason it did that is when I did that commit, it's actually thrown everything out of the session because it's finished with it. So if I look at the set of what's in the session now, all there is Ed who I've asked for back, but all the other guys have been flushed up with the database, they're not part of that session anymore. So the life cycle of a session is when you close the session, which can happen by committing or by running back, or you can call the session.close, it no longer has those records. This is actually quite helpful. So you don't want to have to recreate a new session object every time you're doing stuff. You don't want all these objects to live on forever in it. Okay.
So it's a continuation of the question about the ordering.
Yeah.
We covered ordering based on dependencies. The example where you created multiple new users,
yeah.
Does it preserve that sort of ordering in the list so that those users will go in with consecutive IDs? Or is that what is it?
I can't remember.
Okay.
but I can look at the source code. I don't want to do that right now. Okay. So, yeah, good question. Okay, so, I think it did. Yes, I think it does. I just don't know how it does that. Okay, so there we go. So when we're asking for Ed's ID, it knows it needs to discover an attribute, which, so it's going to do a full query to reload that user back into the current session. Okay. Id is not the greatest name. Let's give him Id Wattle. And he'll be cooler. And let's also add somebody else. So what we want to look at now is what happens when you actually do a rollback. So I'm going to make some changes, and then we're going to see what happens when you roll them back. So these changes, fake user doesn't yet exist in the database, and Id's name change hasn't happened. We're going to put fake user in here, and we're going to do a query. So what is this going to make happen? It's actually going to do a flush, so it won't get committed. So the point, it is going to send all those things to the database, but it won't get committed. So it's not going to have a side effect on other people looking at the database until we get to that point. But I'm going to ask for anyone called it auto fake user. So there we go. It's running update users, insertions to users. So auto and fake user are now real in our session on the database side. And then we're going to query for them, and it's going to give them that. But after deciding that that's not such a good idea, we might want to roll it back. Okay. So it's issued a rollback statement to the database. And its name has changed. So now, because we've done a rollback, it's been thrown out of the session. If I ask for an attribute on him, it's going to pull him back out of the database. And because we've rolled back, he's still called Id. Okay. Your database doesn't support rollback. Even SQLite does that, and it's terrible. Yeah. So, yeah, so this is that's the rollback statement that gets issued to the database. No. So it maintains things until the point at which it does a flash, and at that point it's trusting the database to be reliable and specific.
So also, continuation to that. Mm-hmm. When you're talking about the session and the flashes and the rollbacks, does this mean that as you're adding things to your session, it's adding it to a database transaction? So it's in some form on the database side, or is it all in Python space and it only goes through?
It's going through the database when it flash happens. So when you add stuff to the session knows these things are the things that I will send through the database.
Okay, it doesn't go to the transaction when the transaction is committed, or is it progressively being added to the transaction?
It's being added every time that a flash happens. So, and flashes will be automatically triggered in some cases on queries, but you can disable that behavior if you don't like that.
No, I'm not sure if the other time is managed to flash, but what happens is if, say, you call flash from within a separate thread, I think you want multiple threads.
Oh yes, then you can deadlock yourself. Great! that's not entirely true. These section objects can live across threads, but some databases have got, at least the database drivers, have got restrictions about whether you can basically use segments on the same connection for multiple threads. So you have to be a little bit careful about that. Normally, I would recommend against using the same session for multiple threads because you could easily confuse yourself. So normally, you're doing different sessions in different threads and then getting those results. And then obviously, you have the normal SQL deadlock things that you have to be careful of. Like, if you make changes here and change there, depending on when you get the result. I don't believe in it. So, I'm not going to defend it. So if it's not supporting an improper transactional model, then is it really a relational database? I don't know. Really much. Okay. I don't know that much about my ISM, which is why I brought to the session. Okay. So fake user is no longer in the session. He's gone out. Goodbye. So we've still got that record there, but it's not no longer attached to a session that's going to be sent there because we threw it out when we did a rollback. Okay. So if I do a query now, it's going to issue the query to the database, and all we've got is Id, and he's still got his sensible name, and so that's fine. Okay, so those are the basics. Okay, so we've covered setting up a table, creating and adding, and doing simple querying on records, looking at statuses, fetching and committing, and how to roll back. Okay. There's no way we're going to get through this whole tutorial. It's all on the web, and you can read it. It's like big. I'll show you the page. Hey, it looks good. Read it. It's great. It actually explains everything that I'm not explaining here as well. But hopefully this will introduce you. Okay, so we want to look at what are the more complex queries that we can do and such like. So let's have a look at that. Okay, so I broke my thing. So I'm going to say I want to query a bunch of users, order them by ID, and broke my scripts. Just bear with me. This is great fun. I didn't actually prepare for this talk, I wrote this thing that lets me do read like and teaching. It just shows that even if you can't type fast, you can still do a demo. Sorry about this. So, I did have a thing going backwards, but I don't want to use it. No, it wasn't Zed, it was Zed. You're right. You got it. Thank you. It doesn't work too well, though. Okay, so we want to actually get some information out of the database. So I've got, for each instance in this query, and I order them, print out the name and the full name. Okay? So that generates a nice query with an order by segment, and they're ordered by ID, so they are inserted in the ID order that we originally want them to be, and there are our users. Okay? So you can order things if you want to order by the name or the surname, you can do that. But what if you don't want to actually get the whole record? What if you want to do a normal SQL thing where you're just selecting two columns? But you can do that too. So I'm going to query, and instead of giving it a class name there, I'm giving it the actual class attributes. And it knows that those class attributes correspond to columns. And so let's look at what happens there. So that actually is doing the same effective end result. But obviously, we don't have proper records here. So let's have a look at what's actually happening. So we're going to query for a record, and we're going to query for a column. And what it returns is actually a special kind of name tuple that it sets up. So this row thing that it returns over there is actually a tuple that's got an attribute for each thing that I asked for, which is typically based on the class name or the column name. So, interesting. You can do different kinds. So sometimes you don't want to just deal with records, and it does give you a usable and same way to do that. So you might also want to change the name or something, and you can do that. So I'm just saying I want to call this name label, so that's going to generate SQL that gives a select this as this result name, and then you've got the corresponding things on your name tuple results. Okay. I don't think that's particularly useful. It's in the tutorial. Okay, so the next thing we have up here is what if you want to alias a table. So sometimes you want to get results from a table and you construct. So this is just basically showing you what you can do in SQL. You can still do an RM there. And I can say, I want this SQL user alias. That's a bit more useful when we get down later, if you're finished this tutorial time, into joining different tables. Sometimes you want to have two copies of the same table. So if you need to join against each other, then you can get a bit confused if you've got two tables with the same name. So at least you can know which is which. So that's a useful way. Okay. And now we want to do slicing. So sometimes you like have a web app you're developing, say it's a blogging app, and you don't want to show all of the users in your system because you have grown successful, and it would take a long time for everybody to read them. So what you want to do is say, I only want to see the subset. And so if you can just use a normal Python slice object on a query, and that will issue a SQL statement that limits it to a certain subset. So let's have a look at that. Okay, so the SQL statement says order by users.id, limit, and offset, and they're passing them in as parameters. There's a limit of two users, and then starts at an offset of one. Okay, so there's some nice Pythonic things you can do with query objects that then map into the SQL world. Okay. But what I spend most of my time doing is generating complicated SQL queries that join things together and filter, so let's have a little look at that. So you can, on a query object, you can say dot filter by, and you get returned a new query object, which has then got an extra where clause basically added into that. So this is showing us who's got the name Ed Jones, and we know it's Ed. Okay. And you can see that it's added where user.format equals and passing Ed Jones as a parameter. Okay, so there's two forms of the filter thing. There's filter by, which just takes a keyword argument, and there's a filter one where you can pass in things using relational operators. So if I say user.fullname equals Ed Jones there, it's taking the column and comparing it to Ed Jones, and so that actually constructs a simple phrase that says this column name is equal to this value. Make sense? Okay. You're a bright lot. So you can compose them and put them together, and it'll generate a query that does an AND on them, basically. And then there's all kinds of other kind of stuff you can do. So if you want to construct a complicated query that says, I want to find all users whose name is not Wendy, but does have a D in it, using that SQL-like operator, so there's some attributes of the columns that will generate an operation, and I want their name to be one of Fred or Mary, and I don't want then we have Fred because he matched that. And we don't have Mary because she doesn't have a D in her name. Okay. Now, one thing I like about queries is that you can actually convert them to SQL by just converting them to a string. So if I've got this one here, which is checking that username is none, and that's the full name, or that the username is none and the full name isn't none, then I can see what that's actually doing in the SQL. And what it's doing is comparing it to null. But if anybody's used, one of the annoying things about different databases is that some of them have really strange concepts about null. Which were part of the SQL standard and we didn't clarify. But so you can't say this is equal to null, because the answer to that, like, is n equal to null, as everybody knows, is null. And so you must say he is null, or he is not null. And so it knows none in Python corresponds to null, and if it's comparing to that, let's use is and is not rather than equals, otherwise we don't really get any useful, I don't know any useful things for using that information anyway. Okay, and then there's also little operators for and or. So if you want to construct complicated little nested query where you're saying, I want to find all users who either have a username of which contains ed or a little y in their full name, and whose password has got a b in them, then we can find out this very interesting information. Fred and Wendy, aren't you glad? Okay, so that's going to construct a simple phrase which has got brackets around the one thing and all, and then an and. So that's okay. So basically, you can do lots of stuff with it. Okay. Then sometimes you want to look and see, you want to order things by a certain name. Sometimes you want to get all the records, and sometimes you only want to get one. Then you can just ask for the first one. But often, what you want to do is you want to get only one, but you don't want there to be any others. It's like highlight that. So we can use dot one, which doesn't let you have more than one result. So I'm going to, there's an exception if you have multiple results. So we're going to try and run that query and see if it only gives us one answer. No! Multiple rows were found. So if you try and query with one, then it'll tell you there's an exception. This is actually very useful in practice. Often you want to look for the one, and you don't want to have to deal with checking each time how many results did I get. So you just ask for one, it'll only give you one little raising exception otherwise. And if it doesn't find any, it'll say, there are none. There can be none anymore. We'll be killed. Okay. And then you can also put in, if you want standard SQL clauses into your thing. So yeah, in my filter, I just passed in ID is less than 224. I could have constructed that using the SQL Alchemy API, but really it would be tiresome. And so, and I'm also passing in a SQL clause for, or straight literal SQL for what I want to order by. So SQL Alchemy will just take that thing and trust that you know what you're doing with SQL and put it into the query. Okay, so there's quite a bit of mixing and matching of different things you can do. Okay. 10 minutes until lunch. Will you last? Okay. And you can even do passing your own parameters in. So if I'm putting my own literal SQL and I want to compare values to something I'm passing as a parameter, then in my filter string I can put colon parameter name, and then I can pass that in with a parameters call, and then that'll do that. That's good. Okay, any questions at this point? This is the boring bit. Yeah.
Query language.
Query language. No, this is the relational databases using SQL only. You shall not use JPQL. But if you really want to do that, there is a whole like set of subclasses for dialects, and you can stretch your own dialects if you wanted to that did something other than SQL. I think it would be terrible waste of time. Rather than use something that does JPQL. I don't know what it is. Oh yes, okay. No, sorry, I don't think so. Okay. You can add things to it. Nice idea. So when we were declaring that class earlier, we put various columns onto it. If you want, you can go and add other columns onto it, and then you can do all kinds of hairy things yourself using SQL Alchemy, which is what we do at our company, and we regret it terribly. Or you can use, there's two libraries, there's one called SQL Alchemy Great, and there's another one which Zeke, who's the author of SQL Alchemy, wrote, whose name escapes me. Anybody know it? Anyway. Which, so basically what you can do with those is you can construct a history of, so normally when you're rolling out things for production usage, you don't want to just change the database schema on the fly, however you feel like. So what you want to do is say, at this version, this is the database schema, and when you want to go from this version to another one, you're adding this column and you need to calculate its results. this way, and then so, and there are extension libraries of super alchemy that do that in a controlled manner. Like this. No, like that. Yeah. You do dot counts and things like that. So you can do session dot query user dot count. So there are a whole bunch of, there's also like fun thing which lets you do results in a particular column. So if you wanted to look for the number of a certain name, whatever, and then you can do group by things. So they that whole API's got stuff for doing that.
Yeah. And somebody talks about all versus one. Are there efficient mechanisms for paging result sets?
So an efficient mechanism?
For paging result sets.
Oh right, you've got that slicing thing that I showed earlier. So you can use that malicious query that only gets you the subset of the results. I know, it's just because this doesn't quite go to the edge, it says 4. See, there's a little thing like this.
Going on.
noise between different tables. So this is a query that's going to look at Ansel. Find me all user addresses that match each other where the address is the email address jack@google.com. And that then constructs a SQL statement that's joining the two things together, and it's found. And it's returning to me because I asked for both user and address. It's returning me a name tuple that contains the user results and the address results to match them all nicely together. Okay, I think we're getting close to the end. Okay, any questions? So, I should probably wrap up here because the worst thing of all would be to be late for lunch. So, you can do, just for reference, eager loading where you have a way of saying, there's some simple ways to do this and then more complicated ways. You can either say, every time you query for users, get all the addresses as well, or you can make it do a query where it joins the tables together and maps everything to those kinds of things. And you can set it up so that when you delete, so you do a session.delete to tell it to delete a record, that it automatically cascades. If you delete a user, it will remove the addresses as well. And you can have many relationships, and you can ask questions. So, any final questions in the last 20 seconds? But otherwise, you can come and talk to me afterwards.